Mentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dear Diary Boy, an exacting mother, her free-spirited son, and their bittersweet adventures in an elite Japanese school. By Kumiko Makihara. The Very Beginning by Deborah Fallows. Narrated by Cindy Kay. A note from the author. The names of many of the individuals and institutions have been changed to protect the privacy of the people involved. The Japanese language diary entries and other writing excerpts from Taro were translated into English by the author. November 16th, 2007. I have dreams every day. Scary dreams, fun dreams, all sorts. An example of a scary dream is I was in a war. I killed 2 people with a sword, but while I was struggling against a third, I lost and died and woke up 2 days later. In another one, I died and went into a grave, but a friend was already in it. I don't want to see dreams like that ever again. A fun dream is like this one. I was jumping up and down on a pancake and moving forward. And then I sunk inside one and got stuck. I came out by eating a pancake that didn't even have any syrup on it. The Very Beginning. June 3rd, 1999. Dr. Natalia gently rests her hand on the baby's chest. Your new mama and papa are here, she says. The infant slumbers peacefully on his back in the metal crib, his arms outstretched and fingers curled into tiny fists. A piece of wire hangs over one side with a plastic rattle attached, his toy. The tall and slender doctor wears a silver and black stone bracelet with matching earrings. Her dark brown hair is neatly coiffed in a short, fringed cut, and her nails are shaped and manicured. I'm always struck by the elegance and sophistication I come across in these far-flung and poor regions of the former Soviet Union. Natalia slides her hand back and forth to slowly wake the child. He opens his eyes. The entrance to Kukshetau is marked by a roadside sign, a steel structure of the city's name atop 2 blue triangular frames. To the left is a cemetery. To the right is the town, located in northern Kazakhstan. On our drive through the dusty streets to the maternity hospital, we see large gray abandoned buildings with broken or missing windows. On the facade of a tall factory are the words, "Bread for the people," in Russian. We have lived with him for 2 weeks and relate to him as our biological son. We believe he also knows us as his mother and father, I say, in the Russian speech I have memorized for the adoption court hearing. I'm so nervous that I have no control over my stiff body, and my words come out in a whisper. But the stenographer is typing. The judge sits with no discernible expression on her face. A few days later, we fly out of Kukshetau on an old Soviet plane that holds about 20 passengers. The rumbling is so loud that I wonder why we're still taxiing, until I look out of the window and see that we are airborne. My 2-month-old son is sleeping on my lap. February 13th, 2006. When I woke up in the morning, there was a strange letter to me inside my diary. Grandma had drawn a picture of Hungry Diary Boy. Diary Boy is a boy that looks like me. Yay, it's a feast. Hooray! Today's diary looks yummy. The Japanese character for word repeatedly fills a bowl with diary book written across it. 1. Before. November 1st, 2004. I'm the only mother on the bus who's not wearing a dark blue suit. There are 6 of us pairs, mothers and young children. We pretend not to see each other. But I know. We all have 1 eye on our kid and the other on our rivals. Taro sits down without offering the seat to me first. And now he's swinging his legs back and forth, The school will be looking for polite and obedient children who reflect good parenting. Have the other mothers noticed our flaws? The competition is going to trump us. Should I have bought a new suit to dress like them, instead of making do with this old gray ensemble that has been my go-to suit for all occasions? It's a pleated Issey Miyake blue sawn and skirt. Stylish and sophisticated. It suits me. But it's not the neat and safe choice that everyone else made. As the bus winds through the urban boulevards, the other moms and kids look serene and confident, focused on their mission ahead of nabbing one of the coveted spots in next year's first grade. The bus pulls into a wide driveway, lined on both sides by towering elm trees, that leads to the school's dark green iron gate. One by one, in silence, we get off and step into the gentle sunlight of the fall afternoon. Signs guide us to the auditorium, where parents are ushered to seats. The kids are lined up and given hanging name tags to slip over their heads. My chest tightens as I watch Taro. A beautiful boy with delicate features, a fair complexion, and silky chestnut-colored hair. Standing so far away from me in formation with the other kids. 5 years old, and facing a fork in life. Today, my beloved will either pass or fail the elementary school exams. As the children march off to their test rooms, we mothers suppress the desire to shout out one more cheer of encouragement to our tiny soldiers. Ojuken. It means to take a test for kindergarten or primary school. The O is an honorific added tongue-in-cheek to the word juken, or test-taking, to suggest that only members of the upper echelon, big on such polite language, can afford the time and cost to prep a young child for entrance exams and, on top of that, pay private school tuition. Taro and I fit that category mostly. My father is a well-known business executive, and my mother's great-grandfather was one of Japan's famed early industrialists, Baron Yataro Iwasaki, for whom Taro was named. Yataro is Taro's full name. But I went off script. I married an American. We adopted a baby, a highly unusual act in Japan. My then-husband and I were working as journalists in Russia when, after I failed to get pregnant and turned 40, we met Taro at a hospital in Kazakhstan. His Kazakh birth mother had left him there a few days after he was born. Taro's porcelain skin tone and light hair suggest his biological father may have been Russian. Then, 3 years after we adopted Taro, I left my husband. In normal Tokyo society today, marrying a gaijin or foreigner and divorce no longer raise eyebrows. But in the exclusive circles of the Ojuken world, a single parent is an anomaly, and a mixed-race child is unusual. Adoption from a country barely known to most Japanese? Unfathomable. The top schools don't want different. They want high-quality, predictable. Oh, you're on your own? The woman on the phone from the exam prep school had said to me 6 months earlier, her voice dropping with disapproval. I had told her I was a busy single parent. That was my excuse for calling so late to inquire about classes. It was already May, and the exams were coming up in November. Most children study for at least 2 years. We had only 6 months to go. A private school might be difficult, she continued. The world of primary school exams viewed single mothers, and in Japan, it's mostly mothers who raise and educate the kids, as too harried to bring up a child properly and too poor to afford private school tuition. Besides, how would a working mother manage the logistics of supervising studies and ferrying a child to and from cram school classes? In my internet searches on Ojuken, I came across anxious queries from single mothers about whether private education was beyond their reach. Can one not enter a private elementary school without a father? Read one entry. The highly competitive schools, or schools for boys and girls of good upbringing, would be difficult, came the reply from one exam info site, adding that for the lower-ranked schools, we don't rule out the possibility. The test prep school woman asked me, could you move in temporarily with your parents, just until the exams? I was renting a small apartment near my parents' house that was close enough for Taro to visit them often, but far enough away to give me my own space. The woman's reasoning was that if I lived with my parents, that would invoke the image of mom and son living comfortably in a suitable house with doting grandparents, as opposed to a neglected child and a strapped parent struggling in tiny quarters. But moving in with my parents wasn't an option. When I left my ex-husband at his posting as a foreign correspondent in Beijing and moved back to Tokyo with Taro, who was then almost three, my parents were perturbed. They were content with their own busy lives. My father was the chairman of a large corporation, and my parents traveled together frequently to overseas conferences. Their nest was brimming without us. My father asked what my plans were going forward, hoping to hear I would be independent. I hadn't thought about my future. I'd been preoccupied with my present and past, going over and over the pros and cons of a marriage to a man who is talented and engaging, intelligent and articulate, but also volatile, deceitful, and philandering. One day I made my decision, packed up, and flew home with Taro, with no idea about what to do next. I just can't understand what you're thinking, my father had grumbled. No, I told the woman. It's not possible to move in with my parents. Why was I even considering a private school? It had been a last-minute notion. As one of those harried single moms, I hadn't given Taro's schooling much thought. After returning to Japan, I had started working as an assistant to the president of a large hotel complex in the south of Japan, and I traveled nearly every week between Tokyo and the resort, a 90-minute plane ride away. My mind was consumed on the logistics of whether to take Taro with me on these trips or leave him with my parents when they were home. Taro attended a neighborhood daycare center, and nearly all of the children there would go on to the local public school, a well-regarded one in an affluent district that I myself had attended. I had always assumed that I would send Taro there, too. Japan has a well-respected public education system that emphasizes a high-level standardized curriculum and a belief that all children have the same potential to learn. There are no gifted tracks in public primary schools that go from grade 1 through 6. Elementary school education also stresses character building alongside academics, instructing children to get along with others, clean their surroundings, and respect their teachers and the environment. Traditionally, only the uber-elite, wealthy, or particularly ambitious families opted out of public schools in their children's early years. Just about 1% of Japanese primary school children attend private schools. I certainly didn't want to segregate Taro at such a young age into that privileged minority. But when Taro's piano teacher heard of my intentions, she urged me to reconsider my apparently simplistic reasoning. I was surprised to find that most of my supposedly liberal and open-minded friends agreed with her, too. Public schools aren't what they used to be, they all said, citing declining academic levels, demoralized teachers, and substandard facilities. Indeed, the share of students going to private junior high schools, which start at seventh grade, has been steadily on the rise. About 7% of Japanese children now attend private secondary schools because their parents believe that they offer higher quality teaching and help pave the way for entry into prestigious high schools and universities. Get your foot in the door early was the common chorus I heard from our piano teacher and my friends. I should aim for a private school with an affiliated upper school that Taro could matriculate into. They argued that it would be easier to prep children for private school entrance exams while they were still young and could be cajoled by their mothers, not to mention the fact that the tests would get more difficult down the line. Well, why not then? What did I have to lose anyway, especially if I had the good public school as a backup? I wasn't familiar with even the names of the private schools, so I just picked my father's alma mater, the school, assuming that legacy would help us. The school had the reputation of being one of the country's highest level elementary schools, both academically and athletically. At the least, we could do what some parents called kinen juken, or commemorative exam taking. Taking the test for the hell of it to have the experience of getting dressed up and stepping into the hallowed halls of prestigious schools. And anyway, how hard could a test for 5 and 6-year-olds be? I was already picturing myself bantering happily with other Ojuken moms, our high-achieving children by our sides. I walked gingerly over to a group of parents sitting in the back of the room at an exam prep school. Taro is having a trial class. The cram school is checking him out before offering enrollment. They don't want a kid who will disrupt the class. They do want a kid who will get into a good school so they can boast about that in their brochures. I take a seat at the end of the parents' row and pray that Taro will sit through class obediently. I see him eyeing this new, hushed environment. The other children, about 10 of them, are already practice dressed for exam day, wearing white polo shirts and navy blue shorts or skirts. They sit with backs straight, hands on their laps, and papers in the middle of their desks with 2 sharpened pencils to the right, lead facing forward. Taro's hands dangle by his sides. A matronly teacher walks in. "Where is your pencil, Taro?" she asks. He breaks into a coy smile and pulls one out from behind his ear. The teacher laughs. I suppress a grin. The other parents remain silent. "What happens from here depends on how much effort the mother puts in," the teacher tells me in her office after class. In other words, how quickly can I bring Taro up to speed on the drill sheets? And can I whip him into shape to sit through the hour-long written test and to perform in the group behavior exams? Suddenly, Taro, who had been instructed to stay in the adjacent room, comes bounding in and jumps onto my lap, his dirty sneakers touching the sofa's edge along the way. When I tell him to wait until I finish talking, he repeatedly shouts in English, "Excuse me, Mama!" So happy to try out the phrase I had just taught him to use when interrupting adults. Since our move back from Beijing to Tokyo, Taro had lost the Chinese he had learned there from his nanny and the English he had spoken with his dad, and spoke only Japanese now. So I had been trying to reteach him English, phrase by phrase. But right now, the focus is on the wild boy in the civilized cram school. I can't yell at him, because then I'd come across as an out-of-control parent. The teacher gives us a cold and knowing smile, and we leave as quickly as possible. My heart is heavy, but Taro is high from his release. He holds my hand and pulls ahead, and I can feel the skip in his step. The exam prep schools are called juku, and they are part of the boundless, multi-billion-dollar ojuken industry that converts every parental anxiety into a business opportunity. In addition to the cram schools and tutoring services, children can sharpen their test skills at mock examinations and overnight study retreats. Department stores sell an array of exam-appropriate clothing and accessories. There are the conservative dark blue suits and dresses for moms, some with discreet pockets to store an amulet from a temple purported to protect the bearer and bring good fortune. There are foldable slippers to wear in classrooms, since outdoor shoes are removed at schools. You can always borrow from the school supply, but that signals to everyone how careless you were to forget your own. There are the dark blue umbrellas with fitted carry bags to place them in, so you don't drip rainwater on the floor of your dream school, and tiny cotton covers to elegantly couch tissue packs. Every child is expected to have tissues in one pocket and a handkerchief in the other. Bookstores have shelves devoted to drill books, school rankings, samples of previous test questions, and how-to publications with titles like The 125 Things You Need to Know About Elementary School Entrance Exams. After several rejections, we finally found a juku that would take us in. A mother from Taro's soccer class had felt sorry for me and referred us to the cram school her son attended. Sakura, which means cherry blossom, was located in a dark studio apartment in an aging building one block back from a busy city street. "It's really too late," said the principal, who appeared to be in her 60s. "But I guess if you're Matsui-san's introduction, I will have to accept you." She handed me an invoice for $700 to cover registration, 1 month's tuition, textbooks, and utilities. There was also a sheet that listed the juku rules that included this entry: "If Sakura concludes that the mother is emotionally unstable, we will ask you to withdraw." Taro began attending Sakura twice a week. The cram school's touted private instruction meant three teachers, each seated in front of a single student, squeezed into one of the two small rooms, going over drill sheets and sample tests. Most schools gave athletic exams too. And for that practice, the teacher would gauge Taro's coordination in some tiny room, instructing, for example, "Hop in one place on your left foot," and count, "Stopwatch in hand," while he bobbed up and down next to a desk, his page boy style hair fluttering about. Each school administers its own unique exams, but they generally include written, art, athletic, and behavioral components, plus an interview. The written tests have a variety of formats. In listening comprehension, children hear a recording of a story followed by questions. For example, they might hear, "Hanako-san went to meet her father. At the crosswalk, she passed a man wearing a white hat. There was a man wearing a sweater and glasses sitting on a park bench. A man wearing a tie got off the bus. There was a man with a mustache by the mailbox. Her father was waiting at the train station. Which one is Hanako-san's father?" And then would be shown a picture of five men, each dressed differently. One is wearing a white hat, two have glasses, another has a tie, and another a mustache. The kids would have to remember that the dad had none of those things and select the figure not wearing any of those items. That's actually an extremely short example. Many recorded stories run for about 5 minutes, and the children don't take notes. While some of the 5- and 6-year-old examinees have already been taught by their parents to read and write, the tests are administered on the premise that children are not yet literate. They respond by marking the illustration that corresponds to the right answer. Listening comprehension turned out to be Taro's strongest area. The other tests were even more challenging, such as those to discern and predict patterns. To solve it, you have to deduce that all of the circles are shifting to the right. Then notice that, in the final box, one circle has been added to the bottom row. Many tests assumed an understanding of scientific concepts well beyond the child's age level. How does the level of liquid in a glass change if you put blocks inside? After putting a sugar cube in different amounts of water, which drink is the sweetest? How many eggs remain if a farmer removes one on rainy days, two on sunny days, none when it's cloudy, and there are three sunny days followed by one rainy day and one cloudy one? There was a test category called joshiki, or common sense, with various subsections like common sense about nature or common sense of the seasons, in which children needed to match rice planting and swallows' nests with springtime and watermelons and cicadas with the summer. In one nature category question, children are shown an illustration of five flowers: tulips, a hyacinth, a morning glory, crocuses, and daffodils. They must then choose an odd one out. The correct answer is the morning glory, because it's the only one that grows from a seed rather than a bulb. Remember, Taro, there are seven dots on a ladybug. A teacher shouted after us as we were leaving class one day. Most urbanites had to learn such nature trivia from books, although the more motivated Ojukan parents arranged study trips to the countryside or sent their children to sleepover cram camps in rural areas. Most nerve-wracking for parents was the common sense on daily life category that tested manners and housekeeping skills, both reflecting how the child had been raised and exposing any slovenly habits learned at home. Taro got a C in table setting on one practice test because he tossed all of the plates when distributing them, according to the teacher's report. Please have him actually set the table at home for review. Ouch. The test was a referendum on my parenting skills, and I'd been caught out. It was true that after an exhausting day, I would lay the spread myself at full speed. Maybe I was tossing plates, rather than let Taro help me. And now we would both pay the price for my impatience. In one session, the children were put into groups and given a picnic sheet, a large bottle of tea, a box of cookies, and some cups and plates. They were expected to serve each other politely and insist that others eat and drink before them, just as well-mannered Japanese adults do so endlessly. The schools were looking for kids not just clever on paper, but also polite and considerate. Any number of these tasks could appear in an exam, and the mothers had to polish their products by November. The art tests assessed proficiency in drawing pictures and making crafts, many of which were tedious, presumably to test patience and dexterity. Taro loathed jigirie, a traditional Japanese art where pictures are created by gluing hand-torn pieces of fibrous wash paper onto a sheet. "You mustn't just rip the paper," the Sakura principal told Taro, holding up a purple sheet to demonstrate. "You have to use your nails to carefully, gently tear away the pieces," she said, as she creased a line down the paper with her nails. Origami, an examiner's favorite, was another weak area for my restless boy. While other children could quickly produce cranes, 19 folds, and water lilies, 28 folds, Taro, after months, mastered only the piano, 10 folds, and the peasant, 12 folds without the trousers. His crayon sketch of a blue train on gray grass, an unschooled depiction of a family trip to northern Japan, earned a D- on a practice test. My five-year-old's GPA was already plummeting. The sports section judged skills like jumping rope, bouncing a ball, skipping, and other agile maneuvers. Being athletic, Taro did well on these, but the tests posed the additional challenge of how well children could follow and remember instructions. There could be a complicated obstacle course where, for example, you twirl a hula hoop twice, then dribble a ball up to one goal, and from there, hop to the next destination. In the group activity screening, the children would be divided into teams and told to solve a task together. They might be given some paper, chopsticks, wire, glue, and scissors, and be asked to make a pond and pretend they are fishing. Perhaps there would be fewer tools than children to see how well they shared, and schools were always watching to see how the kids handled equipment. Do you give the scissors to your friend with the blades facing respectfully toward you rather than pointing dangerously at the recipient? Do you pass things on politely using both hands? And when you're done, do you leave everything on the floor, which suggests that at home, mom puts away the toys? Or do you gather them neatly in a corner, revealing a good upbringing? You see? I remember saying to Taro in one of our typical attempts at tackling Sakura's daily homework assignments. For what seemed like the 10th time that evening, I shoved a baseball cap sideways on Taro's head and pointed to the mirror that I had placed before him. The brim is on the opposite side. We were practicing a test question where the children would be shown a picture of a reflection in a mirror of a child wearing a cap sideways, and then presented with two pictures of the same child, but with the brims in different directions. Which is the accurate reflection? I wasn't trying to explain scientific theory. I just wanted Taro to memorize that reflections appear opposite so he could check the correct box on the test. But Taro never got it. He barely knew right from left, for that matter. I couldn't think of a way to get Taro to master this question other than to repeat the process over and over again. Show him the mirror, point to the brim on his head, point to the brim in the mirror, exclaim with enthusiasm that the brim appears on the opposite direction in reflections. To my growing irritation, Taro didn't seem to be trying. He squirmed in his chair, dangled his legs, slumped over on the table, and shouted out any answer. "This one!" I was momentarily thrilled with a correct reply, only to realize he had made a lucky guess. "Look carefully. Don't you get it?" I shouted, forcefully pressing the cap down on his head. "I quit," Taro said, and raced out of the room. I ran after him and grabbed him and dragged him back to the table. It was like this nearly every time. Sakura's principal became increasingly high-strung the closer it got to November. She disapproved of our plans to spend the month of July in New York City. My brother and his family lived there, and I had arranged for us to stay in his apartment while they were away for the summer. I had enrolled Taro in a day camp to expose him to the English language and another culture. From the principal's point of view, such ventures only detracted from exam prep. "They say you should do as many drill sheets as your height when they're piled up," she told me. "But I don't think you'll be able to." She handed me an exercise book to take with us that was less than 1 inch thick. Still, that would be enough to send the daggers flying. Every morning after breakfast, I would try to coax Taro into doing a few sheets. I could spend 2 fruitless hours trying to teach him a concept like recognizing the hidden components in a drawing of a pile of building blocks. That type of question required children to figure out the number of blocks in the rear of a 3-dimensional pile that weren't directly visible in the picture. I would display some real blocks and walk Taro around them to show him the different perspectives. Like the baseball cap reflection, he couldn't grasp the notion, and we would end up in an angry standoff with scuffles and chases around the apartment. Each day, we left the apartment ragged. And I worried that Taro might take his frustrations out by pummeling a campmate. I felt sick with panic when I thought about how much Taro didn't know and very likely wouldn't ingest by exam day. Whenever we faced a new task, I wondered why a child needed to master it to enter elementary school. But I ignored my own questions and lamented Taro's inabilities. I lay low and ran with the herd. Why wasn't I standing tall and judging my son on his own merits? I was educated and worldly, after all. More than a decade older than most of the other Ojukan moms, who were in their 20s and 30s, I had enjoyed a far more varied life. As far as I could tell, most of them had held one job out of school and then stopped working when they had children to devote themselves to homemaking and child-rearing, which is a typical life pattern for Japanese women. I had lived in cities around the world and worked as a foreign correspondent for Time magazine in Tokyo and in Russia as a features editor at the Moscow Times. You would have expected me to have a broader and wiser perspective. But instead, I had tunnel vision. I was obsessed with making sure I had the correct tissue pack cover. I measured Taro by the stick of the cram school. and I was sinking deeper every day into the quicksand of exam hell. I attribute my ultra-compliance to Japanese social mores to three things: my personality, my upbringing, and Japan's conformist culture. I've always been hyper-vigilant and prone to freewheeling fantasy. Like, I'll notice a shard of glass on a sidewalk, and next thing I'll imagine is the prick and pain of it piercing my bare foot, and see the thick ooze of deep red blood. In my early childhood spent in the suburbs of London where my father's job had taken us, my busy mind was happy. My bountiful observations were rich fodder for make-believe with my older brother, our friends, and my dolls. And my flights of fancy always had a safe place to return to, the unwavering base of the familiar, the small private school I attended from age 3, my own bedroom upstairs in our 2-story house in Purley, with lawns in the front and back, and the blue and white Triumph coupe in which my mother drove me to school and my ballet and piano lessons. This secure existence shattered at age 8, when my father's employer ordered him to transfer back to Tokyo. On that sunny morning, my brother, who was 9, and I had been studying the rips in the dining room wallpaper, suspected to be the mischief of a squirrel, when my father announced we were moving back to the hometown I had left when I was 1. "What's Japan like?" I asked. "It's wonderful," my father said. "Everything will be great." 1 month later, my brother and I were trudging along a dirt road in the city of Kawasaki, just south of Tokyo, following a group of neighborhood children to our new school. We had moved into a small 3-room apartment, as the housing situation in Japan was far below the standards of England. We didn't know the route to school yet, around the open sewers, rice paddies, and tiny houses with corrugated aluminum roofs. Once there, groups of kids would surround me and finger my clothes and mimic my replies to their questions. The girls tugged at the straps of my British navy wool jumper skirt, so unlike the thin cotton ones they wore. "My English is better than my Japanese," one of them would say in a low tone, mocking my deep voice. I had told them that in the hopes that they would be forgiving about any mistakes I made in Japanese. But I soon learned that in Japan, anything different, from clothes to speech, would be pointed out as a reason for exclusion. And everyone always seemed to be with someone else, whether to walk to the bathroom or play during recess. Even tag was played as a chain tag, where you hold hands once you're caught, so that it was a group of kids rather than an individual. Confused and miserable, every day after school, I came home and cried and complained to my mother that no one liked me. "Just try to be like everyone else," she advised. "Don't say you speak English. It makes you sound snobbish and makes people jealous." The singular message from my parents was that Japan was a great place that I should accept and acquiesce to and never question. That would take a blind leap of faith coming from a private school in tranquil and verdant Purley to a public school in the smog-engulfed industrial city of Kawasaki in the late 1960s. Japan felt rough and dirty. In England, school assembly meetings had taken place indoors, where we sat at our desks or on the bleachers. In Japan, the morning gatherings were outside, and everyone stood at attention, facing a podium from where teachers made speeches and announcements. During the hot and humid summer months, students sometimes fainted or even vomited. The drama of someone suddenly collapsing frightened me. Even more disturbing was the nonchalant reaction of the teachers and other students who mechanically assisted the child to his or her feet and casually kicked sand to cover the wretch. The British school looked like an old mansion, and the bathrooms were cozy little rooms down the hallway with chains hanging from a tank above to flush. My Japanese school was a standard 3-story cement block building, and had pit toilets where the dark and smelly shafts seemed to go down forever, and were the source of horror stories like the one of a ghost girl who had fallen in long ago and still lived down there. At recess in England, we polished chestnut seeds, called conkers, and ran around an asphalt playground with a climbing structure and slide. In Japan, the kids played fierce dodgeball, and the girls competed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.